Hi, Jan.
Hi there.
Last month, the Federal Reserve updated its monetary policy framework and, as part of that, announced a key shift in its approach to handling inflation. Before we get into that shift, can you give us some context on how the Fed has approached inflation in recent years leading up to this moment?
So they introduced a formal inflation target back in 2012, and it was a symmetric 2% target, which basically meant that whatever happened to inflation in the years leading up to the current one, you always want to have 2% inflation. That's always the optimal level. However, because the business cycle is asymmetric and recessions are generally sharper than booms and inflation declines in recessions are bigger than potential inflation overshoots in booms, that meant that the bigger downside misses gave you an average of less than 2% over the cycle as a whole.
So the new policy targets inflation that averages 2% over time. Why does that matter?
It matters because they now will basically target 2.25% or 2.5% inflation in the strong part of the business cycle. They will take into account past misses, especially past misses on the downside, and that should ensure that over time, it actually will average 2%. And so effectively, it's a small effective increase in the inflation target. That also is going to mean that there will probably be a little bit more room to ease monetary policy via interest rate cuts in recessions, assuming that slightly higher inflation expectations are also built into nominal interest rates. So it gives you a bit more room to respond to a downturn in the economy.
Well, what about the Phillips curve, which has been a fundamental tenet of the Fed's approach to inflation? Does this represent an abandonment of that philosophy?
I wouldn't go quite that far, but it certainly means a downgrade of the Phillips curve. Phillips curve is the relationship between inflation and unemployment, and there is a statistical relationship, but especially in recent decades, it hasn't been particularly strong, and the quantitative impact of a, say, 1 percentage point decline in the unemployment rate on inflation that you observe in the data is now quite a bit smaller than it would have been 30 or 40 years ago. And so they've basically recognized that fact, and therefore they're becoming a little bit less preemptive. They're much less willing to tighten monetary policy just on the basis of declining unemployment rate, because they're not as alarmed about the potential inflationary consequences of that. So downgrading, yes, abandonment, I think probably not.
So how significant is this shift in policy really?
I think it is moderately significant. It's not a huge increase in the inflation target, but it, I think at least in the shorter term, can have a significant impact on the point in the cycle at which you start to see interest rate increases and the willingness that they're going to show to let the unemployment rate decline and more people to find jobs, basically. So if you look at the last cycle, for example, tightening cycle of 2015 to 2018, they probably would have started later and would have maybe also gone a little bit more slowly. And that would have given you a probably bigger labor market improvement, and you know, would have meant that more people would have found jobs. So I think it is significant, and it is something that economic forecasters are going to be building into their expectations, and I think it can make a difference.
So Jan, from a practical perspective, what do you think average inflation targeting might mean for monetary policy?
Well, I think it is one reason why interest rate hikes and tighter monetary policy are still very far away. Our forecast is early 2025 for the first hike in the funds rate. That's 5 years away, or almost 5 years away. Obviously a very long time, and I should say that there's a lot of uncertainty around that because, of course, it depends on how the economy does. But I do think that the changes that the Fed has made are supportive of this forecast that is still a very long time away. Now, we didn't make any changes to our forecast in the wake of this announcement, but the reason for that is basically that the change in the Fed's thinking has been a while in coming. This framework review has been ongoing for a while. So on the day, there wasn't a huge surprise here. But I would say that the change over the last year or two in the thinking certainly is important for how we're predicting monetary policy as well.
So finally, Jan, in a recent note to clients, you also highlighted some limitations to average inflation targeting. What are some of those?
Well, I would say two things, and I don't think either of them is a major problem, but they are things to think about. One is that if you're very concerned about not having enough room to ease monetary policy in a downturn, this is only going to make you feel kind of moderately better, because it's only a relatively small increase in the effective inflation target of a few tenths of a percentage point. So if that gets built into inflation expectations, if it gets built into nominal interest rates, maybe it gives you an extra 25 basis point cut that you can do if the economy turns down. It's not massive. The other point to keep in mind is that the frameworks may be a little bit more complicated. I mean, previously, when you say it's a symmetric 2% inflation target, there is a very clear answer to the question, what inflation rate would you like to achieve next year? The answer is 2%. Now it's a bit more complicated because it depends on what's happened to inflation in the past and how much perhaps you've undershot. So perhaps that makes it a little bit less clear. But overall, I would say that these are minor quibbles as opposed to major problems with the new framework. I think the new framework is generally quite well thought out and a sensible change.
Thanks, Jan.
Thank you.